for this program and all of our programs, the pharmaceutical industry provides us the dollars to do these programs. And to do today's program, I, and I hope all of you too, can appreciate what we got from Biogen to do this program. So I would like to thank them, and I hope you all do too. Round of applause, that would be nice. All right, so our first speaker tonight is going to be Dr. Broz, and Dr. Broz is going to be speaking with you about the challenges of MS from a neurocognitive perspective. So Dr. Broz and Dr. Subei are both from Memorial Neuroscience Institute that's up in Hollywood. And this is a facility that I got to tour one day and is state of the art. I mean, you guys are going to love it if you ever get over there. If you ever make an appointment to go see these people, you are going to love the amount of options that you have to do at their facility. So, right there.
Yeah.
You get to see everything. Okay. Dr. Broz, thank you.
Good evening, everyone. So, yes, Madiley Broz, clinical neuropsychologist for Memorial Neuroscience Institute, Department of Neurology. I am honored and very happy to be here this evening to discuss with you my portion of the MS care that we're trying to establish at Memorial with the amazing Dr. Subei, and we're trying to create a comprehensive MS center. So if you have any questions, we're going to leave it to the end when Dr. Subei is finished, and then we're going to get started. So my talk has to do with the challenges that MS actually possesses from a neurocognitive perspective. And we're going to go over what neuropsychological testing is and how to recognize the need, as well as the recommendations that I have from a neurocognitive view. So first of all, I want to lay out for you what my objective is with my talk on neurocognitive impairments and the view. So I want you all to have an understanding, a basic understanding of what neuropsychology is, its use, purpose, application. We're going to go over briefly the neurocognitive domains, the testing evaluation process, the clinical interview process with the key demographic factors that are very important for us neuropsychologists. And we're going to go over briefly the neuropsychological batteries that we use to get all that good information that we need from you, and the psychometrics when it comes to scoring, administration, and the report writing and interpretation to lead to a diagnosis. So anybody know what neuropsychology is about? If I can just have a show of hands, if you can all show me if you know what it is about. It's a relatively new discipline within psychology. So I want to actually explain to you what that is about. So it's actually the study of brain and behavior relationships so that we can have a better understanding of brain functioning from behavior. So just like an MRI takes a picture of your brain and other imaging studies looking at structural changes in the brain, we actually look at the more subtle kind of changes that might not be captured by diagnostic imaging. So we do that by using objective standardized measures, guided observations, which actually help us to develop a better understanding of how you're functioning cognitively. And we're concerned with developmental as well as an acquired brain injury. And we're going to go over that also. So cognitive impairment in MS. Dementia, good news, it's not common in MS, okay? So it actually occurs in less than 5% of the patients. It is only encountered on those individuals that show severe cognitive deficits, okay? And it's usually more associated with an underlying neurodegenerative condition, not MS. So when evaluated with neuropsychological testing, it's a high percentage, like 70% of MS patients have cognitive impairment, but it doesn't have to be disabling at all. So the prevalence of cortical syndromes such as aphasia, apraxia, and anosmia is low in MS, okay? So usually the degree of cognitive decline in patients with MS associates pretty well with the severity of the atrophy that we see from cerebral pathology and the brain burden on MRI, including the presence of T1 black holes, so the tissue loss, an atrophy of the corpus callosum and thalamus, structures of the brain. And then we also look at the cortical atrophy on MRI. So with the cognitive changes, before we used to think that it was all just mainly, primarily due to white matter changes, but also correlates with gray matter changes, so we look at both. Okay, so what is the neuropsychological evaluation composed of? I know that we have an understanding that it's a tedious process, it's long, and it is true, but in neurology we try to keep it to the minimum, okay, that we can to get as much of the information that we're looking at. So the assessment, so the testing, you will hear this from your neurologist if they're referring you to neuropsych testing, it's composed of a set of a standardized battery of tests that are sensitive to the effect of brain dysfunction. So we know exactly what we're looking for based on the data that we have and the research available. We know exactly the associated cognitive deficits or related changes that we see within MS, and that's what the battery of tests would be looking. So unlike CT and MRI scans, which show abnormalities, like I said, in the structure of the brain, or EEG, which shows electrical, you know, abnormalities, NP testing, neuropsychological testing, will actually will be able to determine what you're able to perform and not perform, okay? So it's more based on behavioral kind of neurology and also mixing psychology, and we're gonna go over that also in a moment. So when we're actually assessing, okay, cognition, and this is for all patients, not just for MS patients, this is exactly what we're looking for. We first have to determine exactly what your premorbid intellectual functioning is. So that is your intellectual ability prior to when you are showing signs of a cognitive change, okay? So before you were even noticing any trouble with your decision-making abilities or poor attention and concentration, all of a sudden just trouble multitasking, not being able to find something in your household, losing your keys, or, you know, not remembering where you parked. I know, I see a lot of heads now saying, yeah. So it happens to me too, and it has to do with multitasking. So we have to determine exactly how you were functioning before. And we do that, this word is gonna be in your vocabulary when you go visit a neuropsychologist, and it's premorbid level of intellectual functioning. So we don't do a thorough intellectual assessment, like an IQ kind of testing, you know, which we normally would do at a younger age, when you're in the school age years. So we actually do that by estimating based on some demographic data, your factors, based on your age, level of education, handedness, and marital status, your occupation. All of that is very important to us, as well as language and years of education, okay? So we also go into testing your verbal abilities, memory and learning, executive functions, attention and concentration, conceptual reasoning, inhibitory processing, visual perceptual abilities, all of that good stuff, okay? And executive functions is actually up in the level of my scale because it's the higher order functioning of all, okay? So what's the purpose of a neuropsychological evaluation? Can I see a show of hands if anybody knows exactly what the purpose is? Why your neurologist would actually be interested in knowing how you're doing cognitively? No? Okay, so it's actually to find the possible problems with brain functioning, just to see, you know, what the MRI or any of the diagnostic measures that they're using, it's not capturing. It's very subtle, but you're reporting to them subjectively some complaints like memory loss or trouble with attention and concentration, not being able to understand what you're reading, trouble with comprehension or expressing yourself. So that might be one of the things that, you know, they want to look into. So to clarify or confirm diagnosis, they know that you have maybe an underlying neurodegenerative condition, but they don't know exactly which one or the degree and severity of it. So that would be the purpose. To define brain-related strengths and weaknesses, we all have strengths and weaknesses. So to guide your treatment for medical, personal, educational, or vocational needs, to provide helpful recommendations, and then to document possible changes and functioning over time. So it's very important to monitor your progress, because that will help also the disease progression, you know, for your neurologist. So the evaluation process, and we can skip through this, it's done, conducted through a clinical interview, like I said, very thorough. I sit down with my patients for about an hour or more. We go over all of your demographic factors, ethnicity, culture factors, language being the key factors to that. And then we go over the onset, the progression of your clinical symptoms. How are you doing with regards to your activities of daily living? How is that affecting your functioning at work? Any behavioral observations, mental status, when you do, how you do in our initial consultation. And then through the results of testing, we will provide, we integrate all of the information with your medical comorbidities, the interview, the standardized testing that we do, and the observations, and then put it all in a very nice report. So that's just to show you what we consider during the clinical interview. It's obviously the presentation, how you look, your affect, your mood, your appearance, your use of vocabulary during that consultation, or your level of insight, which is very important to us. How dependent or independent are you with your activities of daily living? If you're able to function, personality exacerbations might be also exacerbated. So we look into that too. So I wanted to go over some of the major neurocognitive domains that are being assessed during the neuropsychological evaluation. And this might be too much for a brief talk, because I need to actually dedicate more time for Dr. Subei, that has also substantial information to present to all of you. So we can actually, you will be able to go through this when you go for an actual neuropsychological evaluation. I'm pretty sure that whoever you choose will be happy to go over the domains with you. But a complex attention, okay, involves sustained attention, divided attention, selective attention. So this goes to show you all the different types, or subtypes, I should say, within one specific domain, okay? So that's why it's so complicated. So sustained attention, selective attention, divided, and I go on to explain exactly the difference between all of that. So I hear some plates. I know everybody is now joining, enjoying their food, so I'm not going to go over that. It's too dense. And then we have executive functioning. This is a big one, okay, because this is where we see most of the changes within the MS population. So it's actually our mental capacity to accomplish tasks, okay? So our planning, decision making, working memory, responding to feedback, our recognition of errors, overriding habits, inhibition, mental flexibility, all of that, you know, it's all part of executive functioning, okay? And then I go into detail to explain what each one of those is. Learning and memory, which is a big one. There's different types of memory, and we are actually interested in learning also what your learning skills are with regards to the strategies that you use for learning the information, whether it is presented verbally or visuospatially or through another modality. It tells us not just about your capacity to actually memorize information, but also the strategies that you use to learn and encode that information so that it could then be retrieved later on. And there's multiple factors that affect your ability to do that, okay? And it's all part of executive functions, but yet we call it aspects of memory. So language is a big one too. Your ability to express yourself, your ability to understand. So this has to do with comprehension, grammar, syntax, all of that good stuff. Perceptual motor, so your ability to do tasks that are of manual dexterity. Your ability to recognize faces, objects, you know, and name them. That's what that is about. And then your social cognition, so your ability to recognize and identify emotions, images, representing both negative and positive. So that's all part of the neuropsychological evaluation, okay? That's what the main domains that we assess. So then when we actually get the scores, we interpret it, and we have to classify or see if you meet criteria for any of the neurocognitive disorders. So these are just a set of a few of the disorders that could actually be triggering your neurocognitive disorder if you do show any signs of it. So those are the main ones. It doesn't have to be necessarily due to MS. We have to look at the pattern of your profile and see if it is MS related or if it's more due to an underlying Alzheimer's disease or vascular disease, a traumatic brain injury. All of that could be also risk factors. Okay, so in determining or classifying major or mild, that this might be actually at this point a little bit more clinical, we have to look at the pattern of scores and see exactly how you perform, okay, within these domains. And if you do have two or more cognitive domains affected, that's what we determine if it's a major neurocognitive disorder or if it's a mild neurocognitive disorder. A mild would be one or more cognitive domains impaired. A major would be two or more. So this is a new classification based on the DSM-5. Before, we used to call it all dementia, okay? Now, when you hear the word major neurocognitive disorder, it's more like equivalent to dementia, okay? And then the mild basically says that, just like it says, one or more, but then your ADLs, your activities of daily living, are not affected yet, okay? And then before, let me go back, before it used to be that to classify for a major neurocognitive disorder, you had to have definitely an impairment in memory. So now, not anymore. Based on the new criteria, you could have actually an impairment in any of those, the complex attention, executive functions, learning and memory, language, perceptual motor, social cognition. So any of the domains that I went over with you earlier. And this is the normal bell curve, and some of you might have actually been exposed to it already. This is what we use to score and to actually interpret the test data, okay? So depending on where you fall in that classification, in what percentile, that would actually determine also if you meet criteria or not for the major or mild, okay? So what other factors impact cognition, okay? What other factors? It's not just related to MS, okay? So, the other factors would be psychological, depression and anxiety being one of the ones on top, psychosocial stressors, sleep hygiene, pain, okay? Fatigue, all of those factors are very important when we're trying to understand your neurocognitive profile. Because it's not just about your performance or formal testing, it's also about how you feel that day. If you're anxious, if you're nervous, you know, if you were just recently diagnosed with MS, I would expect for you to be sad, to have some feelings of hopelessness and helplessness, to feel like the world is coming to an end, be worrying about your condition and then what your life now is about to become. So all of these things also we take into consideration when we're trying to interpret the results of the formal testing, okay? And then we determine if that's clinically significant or not, depending on your endorsement of these symptoms, in order for it to be impacting your cognition. Alrighty, so those are some of the major symptoms based on the Beck Depression Inventory and the Beck Anxiety Inventory. Those are the domains or the aspects that we go through for depression and anxiety, which are the most common emotional symptoms within not just MS, but any medical condition, okay? Sadness, like I said, hopelessness, helplessness, loss of interest, fear of the worst happening. Those are the most common ones, okay? So depression in itself, when it's clinically elevated, it reduces your performance, just like I said before, on neuropsychological measures, especially in patients with known risk factors for cognitive dysfunction, such as those with traumatic brain injury. So any insult that we've had to the brain or any prior neurological condition, of course, is a risk factor, you know, aside from the MS itself. So executive functioning, it's especially vulnerable to depression, such as working memory, Planning ability, information processing speed, and non-speed at central executive skills are actually very sensitive to depression. And this can lead a turn into impaired problem solving and poor coping strategies. So this is why it's so important to recognize, you know, your emotional functioning, how you feel, you know, the day that you're being tested as well. So some of the treatment recommendations. So we have pharmacological and we have non-pharmacological treatments for the cognitive impairment observed in MS. So obviously the first one would be the disease-modifying medications, and that would be of the choice of your neurologist who is already treating you with those. And then we also have some evidence from research that has been done that cholinesterase inhibitors, okay, also have a modestly beneficial effect to the cognitive decline in MS, okay? So although cholinesterase inhibitors have actually been proven to have a beneficial effect in Alzheimer's disease, you know, we've had studies showing that it can benefit also the cognitive dysfunctions in patients with MS, okay? So at a low dose. So you might have actually been familiar with Aricept, donepezil. So your neurologist would actually, if he feels appropriate prescribing that, would actually recommend that for you for your cognitive dysfunction. Some other treatment recommendations in concomitant with the treatment for the cognitive impairment would be antidepressant medications. But these are selected based on what is really chosen by your neurologist, what it's appropriate, depending on the other comorbidities that you have. Like if you're also experiencing anxiety, pain and fatigue, urinary incontinence, excessive somnolence. So it's not just an antidepressant medication that would be suitable for everybody. It needs to be chosen carefully by your neurologist. So non-pharmaceutical approaches, which is more of like my area, would be individual psychotherapy to address your emotional symptoms, for example, past trauma, limitations from medical conditions, and learn the healthy, effective coping strategies in dealing with your daily stressors. For instance, dealing now with the change of being diagnosed with a new condition, you have to process that. You have to accept it in order for you to move on with your life, because it impacts, you know, your life at many levels. So through this modality, you're able to actually express your feelings and concerns in a safe environment with the therapist of your choice. It could be a clinical psychologist, a neuropsychologist, a mental health counselor. Treatment goals and objectives will be tailored to each patient's symptom presentation and given the stressors. So it will be individualized. And basically the focus would be on acceptance and in creating or recreating yourself now, you know, based on what you have. So also support, I find it to be very important, okay? It's a very important factor because I encourage all of my patients to get involved with community events, in support groups to relate to others with MS, understand others' own situation, network, support each other. I'm very happy that now at Memorial, we're having a support group for our patients, and I think it's a wonderful idea. It's a small group now, but I'm hoping that we will have more patients joining our support group. So I'm really looking forward to that. Also, assistance from family members. Don't be afraid to express to your family members how you feel and get them involved in your care, okay? Your friends, your coworkers, your caregivers, if they really care about you, I am sure that they will be there for you, to support you, okay? So the big one right now, cognitive rehabilitation. What do we do when we know that we have this cognitive impairments, okay? Of course, there's always a solution. There are things that we can do to help ourselves. Just like whenever we're dealing with a chronic medical condition, whether it is our heart, our brain, anything, we have to do something about it in a very responsible way. And in cognitive rehabilitation, what we do is that we use your strengths, so the abilities, your neurocognitive abilities that are very well preserved and that we identify to be in that high range, you know, on your scores, we use it as a compensatory strategy so that you can compensate for your weaknesses, for your cognitive weaknesses. So, and we oftentimes, you know, tell our patients to use all of these strategies, to use personal organizers, alarm clocks, written reminders, directions, phone logs, use all of that. Don't rely just on your brain, okay? Because you won't be able to remember, especially when we're trying, when we have so much going on in our lives. You know, you have kids, you're a working mom, you have a husband, and you have to, you can do it all, okay? So you have to rely on these strategies. Pacing activities to manage physical and cognitive fatigue, so taking frequent breaks, 15-minute rule, it's actually a good rule. So you, every 15 minutes, if you're reading a book, just take a quick break for 2 minutes and continue later on. Okay? Instead of just getting frustrated and saying, oh my God, I don't understand anything that I'm reading. No, go ahead and give yourself the time for your brain to rest and go back to it. Okay? That will be more beneficial. So they have done research studies on the effect of cognitive rehabilitation because, I mean, we have this understanding that after the age of 40, really the brain doesn't really respond to cognitive rehabilitation. But there's been recent studies showing that we do, we can actually benefit from that. So one of the, this group in New Jersey, the Kessler Foundation Neuropsychology and Neuroscience Institute, conducted a study which is, came out in the January 2017 Neurology Journal, and it says that by doing memory tasks, we actually benefit on memory, kind of a span, working memory and immediate visual memory. But they didn't see any improvement on attention, processing speed, executive functions, or any of that. However, the good news is that for executive dysfunctions, we can use compensatory strategies. What I went over with you just in the last slide, we could use all of those organizational strategies to actually compensate for the executive dysfunctions, okay? So this is actually the study that I was talking about, and it's a nice study of 85 patients with memory deficits, and then that's the inclusion criteria, and that they were using the CVLT, the California Verbal Learning Test, to assess. They did a baseline and a follow-up study, and they saw a 22% increase or improvement in cognition when it comes to memory. So my general recommendations, and I usually tell all of my patients, the ultimate goal for all of us, whether we have MS or we don't, is to maintain a healthy and active life, including physical, mental, and social aspects, okay? A healthy body, a healthy mind, it's a happy life. So we have to, it's been proven that aerobic exercise, it's actually very beneficial for the brain. It's the oxygen influx that goes into our brain that helps us. And it actually goes against oxidative stress in the brain. So I highly recommend an exercise regimen that might be recommended by your general practitioner or your neurologist. It's beneficial. I want to thank you all for allowing me to be a presenter for you here today. And I just want you to take a moment to read this beautiful quote. It says, a strong person is not the only, it's not the one who doesn't cry. A strong person is the one who cries and sheds tears for a moment, then gets up and fights again. Okay?
Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you.
You're welcome.
Our next speaker is gonna be Dr. Subei from Memorial Neuroscience Institute. That is such a tongue twister, but one day we'll get it right. So thank you. Let's get started.
Thank you, everyone. Good evening. I don't know if I could beat Dr. Broz's presentation in the video, but I'll try. So I'm a neurologist, and I'm also an MS specialist. I trained at Michigan State. I'm from Michigan. And then I did my multiple sclerosis fellowship at Cleveland Clinic in Ohio at the Mellon Center for MS. And I came down to South Florida, and I joined Memorial to start their MS center. And we're located in Hollywood. I've been there almost 2 years now, and it's been great so far. So I'm going to talk about the treatment and management of multiple sclerosis, which is very extensive, and I'll try to do my best to be on time. So All right, I do want to let you know that I did a consultation for Genzyme related to the study, but I declined any fees for them. So everyone knows in this audience what MS is, or I hope you do. It's an autoimmune disease that affects the brain and spinal cord, and you see these lesions, and these are the locations of the attacks. So when it comes to the treatment of MS, it's really important to understand how we treat it, because a lot of times patients have the misconception that their therapy is not working, and so this slide is one of the most important ones. So whenever someone has an acute MS exacerbation or relapse, so that's what I'm showing you in the blue square. And then you treat that, but then you also have a chronic disease-modifying therapy that you have to do. And this is something that you will continue to take throughout the course of your life, maybe, or your disease. And then there are also symptomatic therapies, which is in the green bar, that they don't treat the MS, but they treat the symptoms. So the disease-modifying therapy doesn't treat the symptoms. So if you feel like you're not getting better or different on the disease-modifying, because you're not supposed to. It's like taking a blood pressure pill. It works, but you don't know that it's working. And so you may have multiple relapses throughout your course, and so you get different treatments for the relapses, but your chronic disease-modifying therapy doesn't change, or maybe it does, but you are still on something. And then you also have multiple or just one symptomatic treatment. It depends on your MS. So the first thing is we're going to talk about the treatment of an acute exacerbation or a relapse. And so when a patient calls me or sees me in the office and they say, hey, I might be having a relapse, I have a new numbness somewhere, or I lost vision or balance, then okay, well, first let's do a few tests. So we check the blood, look at electrolytes, cell count, you know, could there be an infection or something else that could explain why you're having these symptoms? Let's check the urine, do a urine analysis. Let's get a chest x-ray if you're having some shortness of breath or coughing. Sometimes these can make old symptoms come back and make it look like a relapse, but it really isn't. And so if we don't find any obvious reason why patients are having this relapse, then okay, let's treat with IV steroids, solumedrol. We do 3 to 5 days of high dose, 1,000 milligrams per day. And you don't necessarily need to go to the hospital. So we could send patients right to the infusion center, get their steroids, and go home. We try to avoid hospitalizations because you could get some other things when you go into the hospital. If the steroids are not enough, sometimes we could have very severe relapses, then we could either do plasmapheresis, kind of filtering of the blood, or we could do IVIG. So there are some other treatments if the steroids are not enough sometimes. And then whether we want to do a course of oral steroids afterwards, we could do that. Or a lot of patients, I don't even do that. So they just get their IV and then they're done. So the next part is we talk about the chronic treatment of MS. So these are the disease-modifying therapies, okay? And so the first part of this is whatever's on the market right now and what we're familiar with. Almost everyone has heard of some of these medications, Avonex, Rebif, Plegridy, the interferons, beta-seron Xtavia, and then the Copaxone, Glatopa are the glatiramer acetate, and then you also have some infusions, which you've heard of, Tesabri and Novantrone. So those aren't relatively new. Now, some of the newer medications, the orals, so Gilenya was the first that came out in 2010. You take it once a day. The first time that you take it, it drops the heart rate a little bit, and then it goes back up. And so the way that we do this is the first time you take it, you get an EKG. If it looks okay, we watch the patient for 6 hours after they take the first pill. We do vital signs every hour. Everything's okay. You do another EKG, and that's it. We don't need to watch you anymore. So the rest of the treatment can happen at home. We do have to watch for some macular edema, some fluid behind the eye, and we also have to do some labs, obviously, to make sure that all the blood testing is okay. Aubagio is another oral medication that came out. It's also one a day. And some of the things that we have to watch for is it has some toxicity in pregnancy, so we have to advise patients about that. It also can cause some elevation in liver function, so we have to watch that. Very rare patients can have some thinning of the hair, not like the cartoon, so we also have to watch that. Aubagio is the only medication that will stay in the system for 8 months or up to 2 years when you stop it. So we have to wash it out if we are going to stop the pill. So you do that with one of two options. Then the third oral medication is Tecfidera. It's a twice-a-day pill compared to the others. Now, I show you here two pill pictures because you start with the low dose and then you slowly go up to the regular dose. Sometimes that's too quick of a jump over 1 week, even though that's what the FDA recommends. But so we do it at a slower pace. And some of the things to watch out for is flushing. Patients can turn red or feel warmth, abdominal pain, diarrhea, nausea. We could try to find ways around these symptoms. And the slower titration, that going up on the dosing, helps with a lot of these symptoms as well. Alemtuzumab or Lemtrada is an IV infusion that started in 2014. And it's a little bit different from the other medications because there are only two courses for most patients. So the first year, you do a course of 5 days that you get a daily IV treatment. And then the second year, you do 3 days, and that's it. The effect, we hope, should last for up to 4 years after the last infusion. As good as it sounds, it also has some issues. This is just to show you that it's dropping the lymphocytes counts. That's what it does. But we have to. Patients can get infusion reactions related to the chemotherapy that they're getting. We also have to watch for other autoimmune diseases, thyroid disease, blood disease, a kidney disease. It may also cause a very small risk of cancer, and then a small risk of infection. So it's a big package, but in the right patient, it's a great medication. And then Zinbrida is the newest that was approved last year, 2015 or 16, and it's an once a month injection, and so it's also a good medication. It may cause some liver toxicity or other autoimmune disease or skin disease, so we have to watch for those things. And so to wrap up these approved, you know, these medications are not all the same. So they each have their pros and cons, but more importantly is they each have their own strength. So usually the neurologist should discuss with the patient, you know, the type of MS that the patient has, how aggressive it is, how mild it is, and decide on the right treatment for the patient. So all our treatments should be tailored, okay? So that's very important. These medications are not the same. So I may recommend one medication to someone, but not the same medication to someone else. And there usually is reasoning as to why we pick one over the other. Obviously, you know, patient lifestyle and comfort plays a role as well. Okay, so I'm going to talk about a few unapproved or emerging therapies in MS. So many of you have heard of rituximab. It's a rheumatoid arthritis medication or a lymphoma medication. It's been around for a while. But we've tested it in MS and we found that it works. So then the company decided to make a cousin drug, a similar medication called ocrelizumab. So ocrelizumab is very similar to rituximab. You get an infusion every 6 months, just like you would do for rituximab. The only difference is sometimes we do 2 weeks infusion in rituximab. So you get one infusion, 2 weeks, another one, and then we stretch it the 6 months. Okay, but both of these medications work well. Rituximab is not approved for MS, but we use it in MS patients. Ocrelizumab filed for FDA, and we are waiting, hopefully next month, March, we would hear something from the FDA. So what's exciting about ocrelizumab is it's the first medication to show promise or effectiveness in primary progressive MS. Okay, and this is information from the trial that was done called Oratorio, just showing that over the span of 2 years, they were able to decrease the progression or the disability that patients acquire. And this is the first time that we've been able to scratch primary progressive or progressive MS. Okay, this is also, you know, more information than you need, but it's showing you that they're able to decrease the number of lesions that patients get and also decrease the shrinkage in brain volume. So very exciting. So ocrelizumab, we're waiting for FDA to give us a notice of their approval. Hopefully it'll be approved for both relapsing remitting MS and primary progressive MS. That's our hope. Moving on, so there's a third B-cell therapy that's coming up, another cousin of rituximab and ocrelizumab, and that's ofatumumab. So ofatumumab is a little bit different, that it's not an IV infusion, but it's an injection that's given monthly. And this is a trial that's ongoing right now, and our center is part of the trial. It's called Asclepios. Basically, is patients would get either Abagio, which is approved for MS, the pill, or they would get that once a month injection, ofatumumab. And so it's a clinical trial, so just like all research, one is fake and one is real. So patients would either go on the real Abagio, fake ofatumumab, or the real ofatumumab, fake Abagio. So in patients that are interested, this is an ongoing trial, and it's in multiple centers. Next, we move on to a little bit of a different category. So this category of these medications are similar to Gilenya, fingolimod, in that they work on the lymph nodes. Basically, we have three drugs that are coming out: ozanimod, ponesimod, and siponimod. So, yes. So basically, it would also be a once-a-day pill that patients would take. The hope is that with these selective medications, it would have less of an effect on the heart, and so maybe we don't need that first dose monitoring that we have to do with Gilenya. So, and the siponimod, the third one, it's exciting also because they did a trial in secondary progressive MS, and it also showed some decrease in disability progression. So we are hoping that we can have another medication that would work on progressive disease. So that's also exciting. But these medications are still in their phase two of trials, and so and starting phase three. So they're very premature, and I wouldn't expect any of them to go into the market in 2 to 3 years. Who knows? So the next part, now that we've talked about the acute treatment of MS, the chronic treatment of MS, then what about the symptoms now? What about me, treating the patient? Okay, so this is what we're focusing on. And this is important because symptoms of MS are very extensive, and many of you are familiar with these symptoms. Fatigue is the most common one. Numbness, tingling is also there. Weakness, vertigo, double vision, diplopia, vision loss, sexual dysfunction, pain, emotional lability, walking problems, gait, spasticity, spasms, jerks, bladder dysfunction, bowel dysfunction, cognitive problems like Dr. Broz mentioned, depression. There are also some less common ones. Speech difficulty, tremor, difficulty breathing, headaches, dysphagia, difficulty swallowing, seizure, itching, hearing loss. So we won't be able to tackle everything, but I will touch on the more frequent ones or important ones. So we're going to talk about mood, cognition, even though Dr. Broz covered it, so I'm going to be brief on that. Sleep, fatigue, pain, bladder, physical activity, gait impairment, and spasticity. So mood and cognitive disorders are very common. Depression is very common, like Dr. Broz mentioned. There's actually a high rate of suicide in patients with MS. And so this is why it's very important to capture those and talk to your physician about those symptoms. Depression can be caused not only, you know, by MS, but there are also outside factors that could affect depression, just like Dr. Broz mentioned. The treatment of depression, most importantly, would be cognitive behavioral therapy. So cognitive rehab, this is why Dr. Broz is very helpful, because she could do the analysis with a neuropsychology battery and then followed by psychotherapy. And that may be more effective than the treatments. Now then, when it comes to the treatment of depression, sometimes patients can have other symptoms, and so we could do a two-for-one. So if patients have neuropathic pain or anxiety, we could use certain medications. If we need to boost energy, we could use like Wellbutrin, for example. If we need to improve sleep, then we could use Remeron. And so, you know, we could sometimes use medications that could treat more than one symptom together. So sleep disorders, also very common. Some factors that, you know, would contribute to insomnia, and whenever a patient tells me that I have difficulty with sleep, then it opens up a big questionnaire. And so, okay, well, tell me about your sleep. Is it, when do you go to bed? When do you wake up? Is your sleep interrupted? If it is interrupted, what interrupts it? So a lot of things that we have to go through. So some of the things that could contribute is spasms, jerks. If you're in pain, that could interrupt your sleep. Periodic limb movement disorder. So if your arms or legs move, like restless leg, that could interrupt that. Nocturia, you have to go to the bathroom, interrupts your sleep. Medication side effects, depression, sleep apnea. So a lot of things affect sleep. So sometimes we need to do a sleep study, polysomnogram, a sleep consult, send you to a sleep doctor to evaluate that. We talk about sleep hygiene, how to improve sleep. No TVs, iPhones, iPads in bed. The bed is used just for sleep. And avoid stimulants, you know, within the past few hours before you go to bed. So that would be something like coffee or alcohol. Then if there's a movement disorder, like a restless leg, then you have to treat that. If there's depression, we have to treat that. So it's very extensive. The next one is fatigue. Now, even though fatigue is maybe the most common MS symptom, I purposely put it after these two. And that's because fatigue is so common, but there are so many things that affect fatigue. So you have to make sure that it's not depression, insomnia, a medication issue, deconditioning, if you have other outside stressors or comorbidities that would explain the fatigue. And then if we say, okay, well, we've looked at everything and I really cannot find an explanation for the fatigue, then we say, okay, then this is just primary MS fatigue, and then that's what we address. Okay. And that could change. So even though, well, 5 years ago, my doctor looked at that and my sleep was fine. Well, that was 5 years ago. Things change, you know, everything is dynamic. So we have to readdress and revisit all these issues to make sure that there's not something else that we're missing. Okay. If there isn't anything else, then maybe we could try a few medications. We don't have many, but we could at least try some for fatigue. Amantadine is the easiest one to try because the insurances don't give us much of a hassle trying it. We could also try Ampira or diaminopyridine. Might need to get that compounded from the pharmacy. We don't use Pemoline. We could use Modafinil or Provigil if you can get the insurance to cover it. Our Modafinil, Nuvigil, if we could get the insurance to cover it. And then sometimes we have to use stimulants, amphetamine, dextroamphetamine, methylphenidate, so some of the ADHD medications that patients take. So then also non-pharmacologic treatments of fatigue would include, you know, mindfulness, meditation, learning ways to just take control of your fatigue. And we actually also work with someone on a mindfulness program to try to help patients with that. We also encourage exercise programs, so things like yoga, cooling, hydrotherapy can also improve fatigue. So believe it or not, the more active you are, the less fatigue you may get. And I say may because there's an asterisk there. Some people it works, some people it doesn't. Pain. Pain is also very common. Pain can be neuropathic, so from nerve pain. You could also have trigeminal neuralgia, glossopharyngeal neuralgia, occipital neuralgia. So those are different cranial nerves that are overactive and they cause pain. You could also have a pain that looks like a radiculopathy. It looks like it's coming from a pinched nerve in the back or in the neck, but it's actually from MS. Or it actually could be from a musculoskeletal problem. It could be a musculoskeletal pain in the muscles or bones. It could be optic neuritis, vision loss could cause you eye pain, headaches, migraines, very common. Spasms could also cause pain. So depending on the cause of the pain, we treat the pain. So this is why we have to understand what type of pain do you feel, where is it, what characteristic is it. So all those help us tailor the treatment of pain. Bladder dysfunction. So also very common. You have to think of the bladder as, is it working too much or is it not working enough? And so an overactive bladder, you get that urge, I gotta go right now. And you go often to the bathroom, you go at night. So that's an overactive bladder. An underactive bladder is, I just went to the bathroom and I have to go again. And then you go and very little comes out. And then you have to go again. And so that's because the bladder is holding the urine and it's not letting you excrete the urine. So sometimes that could be a muscle that's too tight, or it's a miscommunication between the brain and the bladder. So a lot of patients is they have a mix of these symptoms, so it's not just one or the other, and so it's tricky on how to treat it. And sometimes we have to, or a lot of times, we have to team with urology to help us figure this out. But we do want to measure at least the post-void residual, so we'll ask the patients to go to the bathroom, try to void as much as they can, and then we measure how much urine is left in the bladder, and then that'll tell us if the bladder is holding back urine. We also check a urinalysis to see if maybe there is a urine infection or something that's causing this bladder to be overactive or underactive. And we check urine culture also. Then, okay, well, some behavior modifications that may help bladder symptoms. And so first is fluid titration. So make sure that you don't drink more than 4 to 6 ounces of water per hour. And so you'd be surprised how small 6 ounces is. So, and then you want to reduce the bladder irritants. So bladder irritants are alcohol, caffeine, citrus, juices, artificial sweeteners. And then you want to cut off fluids 2 to 3 hours before you go to bed. So that way you'll hopefully wake up less often to go to the bathroom. Change the medication. So if you're taking a water pill for your blood pressure or heart, then maybe you shouldn't be taking it so late at night, because then you're going to need to go pee in the middle of the night. You also might want to try scheduled voiding, so that every few hours, okay, I got to go because it's time to go. And that way you train your bladder that you're going to work on my schedule, not yours. And then Kegel exercises sometimes could help. And it'll improve your voluntary control, the muscles that control the bladder. So sometimes those help. And we have some medications that treat an overactive bladder and an underactive bladder. So usually, you know, a neurologist may start you on something by the time you go see a urologist, and then maybe they'll adjust the medications. And it's basically a trial and error, what works and what doesn't. If medications are not enough, then sometimes we could do other things to help the bladder. And so we could do Botox to the bladder. Neuromodulation or neurostimulation. So we put in some wires and we stimulate electrically the bladder. And then sometimes what we have to do is catheterization. So whether that's self-catheterization, so you put in the catheter, empty out the bladder, take it out. Or you could just do a Foley catheter, but that has its own issues and it's not as recommended. Physical activity, very important, and I'll tell you why. So before the year 2000, so this was the stone age of MS treatment. Why? Because neurologists, believe it or not, we used to tell patients is, don't exercise, don't exhaust yourself, because you're just going to get worse. We were wrong, okay? So it turns out, the more active you are, the better it is. And this is, the American Academy of Neurology came out with this review 2 years ago now. And so they went over all the literature on rehab and MS, and they filtered them out and found out that patients who do weekly home exercises, outpatient physical therapy, have a much better balance, disability, and walking steadiness. And patients who do inpatient exercises for about 3 weeks, followed by the home exercise, they also improve their disability. And then those who, you know, have done 6 week comprehensive multidisciplinary outpatient rehabilitation, that also improves their So the bottom line is rehab, therapy, activity. And so it surprises me. I talk to a lot of patients, is, when was the last time you saw a therapist? Like, never? Or, oh, back when I was diagnosed 10 years ago. So, and sometimes we get lost and we forget about these things, but we have to remember that the more activity we do, then the better the MS is, because if you don't use it, you lose it. So, and we'll talk about that. So this is another study. This is interesting, and I'll tell you why, because this is looking at kids with MS. So they took pediatrics, kids aged 5 to 18. And, you know, they took some that were diagnosed with MS and some that were diagnosed with, you know, autoimmune diseases similar to MS, okay? And so kids don't have usually blood pressure problems, diabetes, other comorbidities that they would get. And look at this, 45% of the kids were physically active, those that have MS, only 45. But those that didn't have MS, 82% were active. So already half of the people, half of the kids with MS are not as active. And these are people, kids who don't have any other medical problems. And then those kids who were involved in more strenuous activity, like running or jogging, they had less lesions on their MRIs than those who weren't active, and they had less relapses. These are kids. They don't have any other disease. So this just tells you that just MS in and of itself, you'd have less disease activity with physical activity. All right, so speaking of that, let's talk about walking, gait. So when it comes to difficulty with walking, there's more than one component to it. And you may not think about this. But motor, whether you're weak in one arm or leg, or you have spasticity, tightness, or you're ataxic, you cannot coordinate your arms or legs. If you have a sensory problem, if you cannot feel the bottom of your feet, then you're going to have a sensory ataxia because you cannot feel the bottom of your feet. And your brain won't know where you're walking unless you look. If you have upper extremity weakness, so then you don't have the normal swing that people have when they walk. So it sways, it completely throws your body off balance. If you're visually impaired, if you have had optic neuritis or a vision problem, then that also affects your walking because then you have less to rely on and more on your sensory pathway. If you have cognitive problem, memory, processing, you can have what we call a gait apraxia, which means that you're completely normal when it comes to strength and you have good sensation, but your brain just cannot put together the process of walking. If you have fatigue, then that'll also affect your gait. Non-MS symptoms like osteoarthritis, yes, MS patients can get other diseases like arthritis or back pain. That would also affect how you walk. Sometimes those could develop from a problem walking, and then it's a vicious cycle. So physical therapy is very important. We encourage stretching, improving the range of motion, strengthening of the extremities. Specific tasks sometimes we focus on is walking, balance, climbing upstairs, need for assist device. So if you need a cane, a walker, or something to help you walk better, then we have to evaluate you for that. In our inpatient rehab hospital at Memorial, we also have this body weight device that takes out the body weight completely, and then patients can just focus on the walking. So that also helps with rehabilitation. Some of the assist devices you're familiar with, a cane, a walker, a rolling walker, the rollator, an ankle foot orthotic, AFO, and that's for people who have foot drop. A hip knee ankle orthotic, a knee orthotic, a hip brace, or even a stimulator, a neurostimulator. And this is one of the devices. There are many others on the market. And it's instead of a plastic AFO, it'll stimulate the nerve so that it lifts up the foot when you're walking. So then even when it comes to wheelchairs, so we try to be creative for MS patients because we're not quitting. So whether it's a standard wheelchair with patients being able to wheel it with their arms, or it's a power chair where it's a joystick that controls the power chair, and that chair could either stand patients up or lay them down. If patients don't have that coordination, sometimes we could use a hand button for them to use, or sometimes they could just push with their head in that center picture. Or even just blowing through a tube, and that'll move the wheelchair. So we try to be creative so that nothing stops mobility. Walking speed. So that's another problem that many patients could get. So we have one medication on the market called Ampira. It's taken twice a day, and it's supposed to improve the conduction of the nerves so that you walk faster. We do have to watch the kidney, so we do a kidney test. Sometimes it could cause seizures, so we have to do an EEG before. But this is a good medication that some patients improves their speed of walking. And by improving the speed of walking, it improves stability. Okay, next is spasticity. Spasticity is very common in MS. And spasticity is velocity dependent, which means that the faster the arm or leg moves, this is where spasticity comes in. So if I'm examining a patient and I'm moving the arm slowly, then I may not pick up any tightness. But if I move it quickly, and then you could get that jerk that locks, and then it could release. Sometimes it's something as mild as just a jerk or a spasm. So that's the mildest form. And then sometimes when it's very severe, then you can get that contracture that you just cannot break. So there's different levels of spasticity, but it's very common in MS patients. And the less active you are, the more likely that you will develop spasticity. So why do we treat spasticity? First of all, because it's painful. So we try to treat the pain associated with it. You could also improve posture. And so, and by improving posture, then maybe you could use an orthotic or an ankle-foot brace, or maybe it improves the body image if you have a better posture. You could also improve the function. So if you want to dress someone, get them in and out of cars, lay them in bed. So, and then also hygiene, to clean patients who are spastic. So you need to treat the spasticity so you're able to clean certain areas. And then you prevent contractures, because whenever you develop contractures, you could develop ulcers and wounds. So that's also important to be addressed. What treats the spasticity? Rehab. So stretching, very important. Orthotics, to try to hold the extremities in place. Serial casting, sometimes you have to do. Oral medications to treat the spasticity. Many of you have heard of baclofen, that's one of them. I know that you're not so excited about baclofen, but it works in some people. There are other medications that also treat spasticity. Focal treatment, sometimes if pills don't help, then maybe we could treat the spasticity with injections. So we could do Botox or phenols to break the spasticity. And we do this with the Memorial Rehab team. We have a team dedicated for MS spasticity. We could do intrathecal baclofen. So if the oral baclofen doesn't work, then we could do it through a pump and deliver it directly to the spinal cord. We have a baclofen pump program. We sometimes need to do surgery. So here's a list of some oral medications for the spasticity. This is what the baclofen pump would look like. It would go straight to the spinal cord in the back, and it would deliver the baclofen, which is in a microscopic dose. So 1/100th of a dose. So it's not like pills. And then we do Botox, so we put the needle in, figure out which muscle we're going to, and then we give the Botox to treat the spasticity. Same thing with the phenols, which is an alcohol that we do for the spasticity. Some of you may wonder about marijuana and spasticity. So the American Academy of Neurology gave us guidelines in 2014, and they looked at many different forms of marijuana and at different doses, and they collected all the studies that did this. So they found is that it helped reduce the patient's perception of the spasticity. But when physicians actually tested the spasticity, it didn't make a difference. So overall, the American Academy of Neurology is not recommending marijuana for spasticity. I understand that patients will still get marijuana for it, and we actually have a division within Memorial, where a clinic where they were able to get it. So in summary, so we have the acute treatment of MS, we have the chronic treatment of MS, and then we have the symptomatic. Each one has its own purpose, and don't confuse one over the other. So I try to emphasize this every time someone walks into my door, because if you understand what the medication is doing for you, then you understand your management. And the more you understand, then the better your management is. And that is my segue into effective communication with the neurologist. And so MS is such an extensive disease with so many symptoms that have to be addressed. And so usually it takes more than a neurologist to treat an MS patient. You've seen this. You've seen this PowerPoint. So, you know, a new visit or a follow-up visit is not enough. And so we make sure that we have a team of a neurologist, a neuropsychologist, a physiatrist, a physical occupational therapist, infusion nurses, an ophthalmologist if needed, a urologist. It takes a country or a village to treat an MS patient. And this is what we have to try to focus on, okay? And I tell a lot of my patients, with these numerous symptoms and these numerous issues, I may not be able to fix someone in one visit, But with time, hopefully we're able to address most of the symptoms to try to improve the quality of life as much as possible. Okay? And with that, I want to thank you. This is the Memorial Neuroscience Institute. We're at Regional and West.
I think that was fabulous. Thank you. So what we're going to do now is we're going to ask Dr. Broz to come on up here as well. And I'm going to run around the room with this microphone, and I'm going to ask you all to raise your hand. I can't be there and there at the same time, but just do know that we're going to do this for about 30 minutes, and we're going to trickle around the room. By the way, before we get into the questions, though, for everybody that did do the remote tabulations with us after, we do need that back. Trust me, it's not going to work with your at-home place systems of any type. It only works with what we have. So we do need it back. We did take a number down, and you don't want to hear from Lisi afterwards, you know, that we didn't get it back from you. So please make sure that you do hand it back. And now I'm going to go around the room. Please raise your hands. I'll acknowledge you when I know that I have to get over to see you, that you have a question. Okay? Who's first so I know where I'm going? Wow, all the way in the back. Here we go.
This question is for this doctor in psychology. You threw up a term there I'd never seen before. Sleep hygiene? What do you mean by that?
So just like Dr. Subei also discussed with sleep is actually an umbrella, okay, of different other disorders, okay, or symptoms, we should say. So it depends really on the type of sleep symptoms that you're having. So we think that if you follow a sleep hygiene, so a good sleep procedure protocol, so different steps, just like he went over not drinking caffeine or not a lot of water, so you don't wake up, you know, in the middle of the night. So those are all protocols that we have to follow in order to have a good night's sleep. So if we're suffering from insomnia, or we're having trouble going to sleep at night, it's not recommended for you to be on your iPad right before going to sleep or have bright lights all over your house. So there is a specific strategies, I should probably say, it's recommended for you to follow before you go to bed. And part of that is also following a structured routine and having the environment optimal for a good night of sleep. So that's part of the psychotherapeutic process that we work with all of you who are presenting with sleep problems. So sleep hygiene is actually the procedure, the modality that we use to address those kind of issues with sleep. Okay?
Next questions over here.
I have a question regarding the marijuana, since medical marijuana has been approved in the state of Florida. Those studies, was it done with low THC or the marijuana as it comes with the THC? Because I've been reading a lot about it and the different strains, and that it helps with not only spasticity, but also for sleep and pain and anxiety, depression, all kinds of things. So, and you mentioned something about at Memorial, you're prescribing it, or what is that about?
Yeah, so my slides were only about spasticity, okay? So I understand the anxiety, the pain, and everything else, okay? Second of all is they looked at oral marijuana, low, high dose. They looked at sublingual, goes under the tongue. They looked at smoking marijuana. So they looked at different forms. And some of these medications were also approved in Europe, and so that's why they were able to look at those also in Europe. We have an integrative medicine clinic at Memorial, which is based at Memorial Hospital West. And Dr. Ashwin Mehta is the one who leads it. And this is our focus there when I send patients, is the natural way of treating MS, which is not alternative to what we're doing, but complementing. Because again, it takes more than one approach to treating MS. And so there at the clinic, if we are to prescribe marijuana, it would be done there.
Next question.
Two questions. The first one is for Dr. Broz. Is there any statistical data of cases of suicide for persons that has been diagnosed with MS, whether there is a correlation or not?
Okay. So definitely, there is a high incidence of depression in MS patients, as well as other neurological conditions. And we know, of course, that there is a high incidence of suicidal ideation, more than attempts, of course. I don't know specifically what the percentage is right now, but it's a high percentage of suicidal ideation. So it's very important to get help. Okay, so psychotherapy would be the way to go. And aside from a good management of psychotropic medication. Okay, you're welcome.
Yes, doctor, I have a question for you. How do you evaluate a person that have the back lift fin done through your spine? How do you evaluate that person to be able to qualify for something of that nature?
Yeah, very good question. So, and this is done at the Memorial Rehab Institute. So, you will, let's just say you go into the clinic, and so they will inject baclofen directly into the spinal canal, and they do a test run. So then they see how your spasticity improved or not. They give about 100 micrograms. And then if it did improve, then they'll proceed with putting in the pump and the tubing and all that. So they're not going to go through that all that hassle if it doesn't work with the trial run. So that's how it's done.
Next question here.
For the same doctor. My question is the difference between the Rituximab and the other medicine you mentioned, the new medicine, the chemical components, is it the same? And also, like, okay. Let's go to the chemical components first.
Yeah, it's rituximab comes from a mouse, and ocrelizumab comes from a human.
So that'll be the only difference?
Well, and then we're looking at biochemistry in terms of what subunit it interacts with on the receptor. That's complicated.
I have a question. You spoke about IVIG, plasmapheresis, if you have an exacerbation and steroids or didn't work effectively, could you talk a little bit more about what that is like?
Sure. So, you know, there's everything that we do is anecdotal. So there's no good data or guidelines in terms of what needs to be done when someone has a relapse. So typically it's, you know, you'll do IV steroids for 3 or 5 days. Sometimes if the relapse is too severe, we may extend the IV steroids longer. But then if we feel like, okay, no matter how much steroids we give, maybe it's not enough for the relapse. So we'll do the plasmapheresis. So it's similar to a dialysis, but it's not dialysis. So patients are hooked up to a machine, and then the blood will go through and it'll filter the plasma, and then it goes back in. We do that every other day for 5 times. Usually patients are in the hospital, they're very sick, and that's why we do it. Alternatively, IVIG, which is an immunoglobulin, so something that also will help decrease that MS activity, and we'll do that for 5 days, and if we feel like the steroids didn't help. IVIG and plasmapheresis, they almost have the same efficacy. There's no difference.
Dr. Subei, I've been on Tysabri for 10 years. Okay, I'm pretty stable, okay, but I was looking forward to going on a drug that could remyelinate, okay, and I heard that anti-lingo was going to be that drug. I think it failed. Are there any drugs coming, you know, in the future that are going to remyelinate all the stuff that MS has destroyed?
Yeah, so that medication is called opicinumab, but it failed in one trial. It did not fail in the other, but they're still in phase 2. Clinical trials are phase 1, phase 2, phase 3. So I think we're not quitting yet on it. They're still trying to figure out the kinks, and then they're going to try it again with another trial. There are one or two other medications for remyelination, but they're still in phase 1, maybe going into phase 2, but it's still premature for remyelination. But we're getting there, hopefully.
Over here, please.
Yes. There was an information about excessive somnology or something like that, that I didn't catch the spelling correctly, but I'm not sure what that means.
Do you mean somnolence?
Maybe, yeah, because I didn't catch
S-O-M-N-O.
Something else, right. Okay.
So is that for Dr. Subei or myself?
For either yourself, of us? Yes, I'm sorry for
you. Oh, okay. So that has to do with, let's say, cognitive fatigue also, and it has to do with how tired you feel. It could be during the testing. It has to do with your stamina, so your ability to sustain the attention and not be tired. We look at that also during the testing, so to make sure that performance is not being impacted, but one of those factors would be somnolence. So basically, not lethargic, but feeling like with low energy and feeling fatigued cognitively. So not all there cognitively, that's what it is.
Okay, so that's part of the evaluation, correct?
It's part of the factors that could actually influence the performance on testing. So whenever we identify that, we usually take breaks. So I mentioned frequent breaks every 15 minutes or so. So part of the evaluation would be to actually recognize those factors as well, because we don't want that to affect your performance on testing. We want to see you at your best. Okay?
Okay, another question, and this will be for Dr. Subei. You mentioned that it takes a village for a person to be treated with MS, but did you mention psychiatric aspect too?
Yes, that's part of it as well.
Okay.
Hi, I have a question. I get that exercise good, but I want to know how much. I mean, the regular exercise, like a strong exercise every day, is that okay for MS? Can we do that?
Don't quote me on this, but there is nothing that you could do that could hurt your MS generally, okay? What I would recommend is, you know, and I said this before and someone else took it the wrong way, but, you know, regular cardio exercise, so whatever brings up your heart rate, gets you moving a little bit, so walking, jogging, a stationary bike, whatever it is just to get you going, you know, 10 minutes, 30 minutes, 1 hour, whatever your stamina is, and then, but spread it out throughout the week. So, and you know, I don't want you to just do a few weeks and then stop completely and the rest of the year you're a couch potato. But if you spread it out routinely throughout the week and then you space it out, then that's the best. Yeah. Yes, she said to go about it slowly. So a slow start and then gradually building up to your stamina.
Thank you, Dr. Subei. My first question is, I have two, they're related. Does Memorial Regional Hospital do any stem cell transplants for MS? And my second one is related to that is, do you know if an autologous stem cell transplant with a lot of chemo, would a patient who has a procedure be put on an MS medication if they don't show any symptoms of MS after the transplant?
I was waiting for the stem cell question. So stem cell is not approved for MS. Stem cell is still in its premature stages of research. Right now there are legitimate phase 2 trials, not phase 3. So these trials right before the launch of something, we're not there yet. Phase 2 focuses on safety and maybe if it works or not. And it's only a small number of patients. So I get the news and the media and everything else that you read on the internet. It's not as great as you think it is. We have not perfected the way that we do it. Some centers will do the autologous stem cells, and so that seems to be the best way to do it. So they give chemo, kind of wipe out the cells in your body, and then you rebuild with the new stem cells. The centers that do this best are the centers that are doing the research. There are a lot of scammers out there, and I know some in the area and some in other countries where patients have paid $25,000 to get this procedure that basically is water putting into their system. So we're not holding back. If stem cells work, we would tell everyone. And if they were, so it's only in select patients who are candidates for the stem cells. And we don't do it at Memorial yet because we only do approved treatments, okay? And I wouldn't recommend you to go to any place. If you really are, talk to your neurologist before you pursue it. Please Don't just go to some random place.
Yeah. Unfortunately, I have cancer and I had a relapse of the I have diffuse large B-cell non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. And I had exactly 13 months ago a stem cell autologous transplant done at a Sylvester here in Miami. And I had so much rituximab and such large doses of chemo that my oncologist says, I don't think you're going to be having NMS anytime soon, symptoms with the bomb that we put in you, like everything I had, the treatment. And I was just curious. I don't know if somebody like me, we're still investigational for MS, should be put on a drug or not for MS. I'm currently not on any MS drugs.
So my answer is to anyone with MS, we always look for no evidence of disease activity, regardless of what you've had. So MRIs routinely, clinical exam, we watch you closely. If there is evidence for MS activity, you need to be on chronic disease modifying therapy, regardless.
I don't know if other people are having the same problem I am with their insurance, and I don't know if this is the place to ask about it, but how can a patient find out if you are covered by their insurance? I've asked my doctors and they tell me to go to the insurance company, ask the insurance company and they tell me to go to the doctor. And I can't really find out who is going to be on my list of in-network doctors. Is there some advice you can give us as to an easy way to find out?
Yeah, the easiest way would be to contact the insurance company, but if you can't get through them, you could just ask the doctor whether they take the insurance, and each doctor's office should and will know whether they do or don't.
Question for you that nobody's asked. Lately in the news, especially on social media, has been a lot of talk about biomarkers. So what can you tell us about biomarkers and how this will eventually help to know what a patient is best to be using?
So this is something that's not yet available and we don't have enough data on, but there are potential biomarkers that will give us some kind of an indication of the MS activity that's going on. And so neurofilament is one of them, and that's still premature and not yet ready for use.
Okay, my first thing is not for them, but for the lady that asked about the insurance. When you call the insurance company or the doctor, don't just ask the doctor if they take your insurance, ask them if they are an in-network provider. It's not the same thing. I've been caught that way. Make sure you ask. Okay, I have another question. For Dr. Broz, hearing a lot about psychotherapy, I don't know exactly what that falls under. I've recently been looking for perhaps a psychologist for myself. I'm not really sure if I need a psychologist, a psychiatrist. What would you recommend?
Yeah, so the question is, what does psychology fall under, or psychotherapy? So it would be behavioral health, okay? And it's a hurdle that we actually go through because oftentimes insurance companies don't want to call it medical, even though it's part of your medical presentation, but it goes under behavioral health. So you have to have behavioral health insurance coverage in order for the insurance to cover for this type of service. So the service is called psychotherapy. Okay, and it's a time kind of service, so depending on how much time the clinician or you need to spend with the clinician, anywhere from 15 minutes to 1 hour, that's how the insurance companies get billed. But it's part of behavioral health. So, and then we choose the modality based on your presenting symptoms. Either we go with what Dr. Subei mentioned before, CBT, cognitive behavioral psychotherapy, or we do interpersonal, or we do solution focused, family systems. Depending on your needs, we are the ones who determine exactly what modality we work with you. Okay.
Anybody have any other questions? Dessert is just coming out, so I need questions. Great.
So I should ask my neurologist who to actually go see regarding
yes,
that? I didn't know, is it put in a certain category, a psychologist, a psychiatrist, psychotherapy, it's all under the same thing? I'm not quite getting it.
Well, the neurologists usually, they do know. They're informed about it. But if they don't, even if you ask your insurance company, I would like to see a psychologist or a psychiatrist, they should be listed under behavioral health. And then they have to be in network.
Okay, thank you. Mm-hmm.
Dr. Broz, do you ever use any hypnotherapy to help those that have too much pain in their body?
No hypnotherapy. I don't have the competence to use it. So for that, you have to be certified specifically in hypnotherapy to use it. I don't.
Okay. Come on, we need questions. There we go.
I will say that we use, at Memorial West, we use acupuncture for pain.
My wife and myself, I'm at the table, we're talking, and I get sleep out, fall out of I'm sleep. I mean, you know, why is that? I mean, she's talking to me and I can't concentrate, I'm falling asleep. I mean, I'm not doing anything. I mean, you know, I drink some coffee, and I think that'll keep me awake, but it doesn't. What is it?
I must be boring.
I was going to say that, but
no. No.
You don't look boring. I would recommend a sleep study, and for you to see a sleep specialist. Sleep study. Because then we need to decide or find out exactly what's the problem with sleep that you're having?
Any other questions? All right, well then I guess everybody's going to sit around and first say thank you to both of these doctors.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
And if you need to know more about Memorial Neuro Institute, they have flyers at the right outside the black curtains, and you'll see a lot of photos of Dr. Subei on those flyers. So thank you again for coming, both of you. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. MSU News is an organization that we pride ourselves on what we were able to get from corporations in the pharmaceutical industry, and as far as providing our programs, whether they be wellness programs or educational programs. Okay, and fortunately, the pharmaceutical industry appreciates the turnouts that we get at our programs. Today, for instance, 70 people. Thank you, everybody, for coming. We have been averaging 72 per program for the last few years, which has been, you know, which has helped us greatly for the patients, for the caregivers. We do programs in a lot of states where it's not just about the patient, it is about the caregiver. We do the impact of MS on the family. I mean, that's a great topic. So, you know, if you have any friends or family that is very close to you and is helping you out with your MS, you can ask them to visit our YouTube channel. All right, and you go to our YouTube channel and you can look up any of the programs we've done in the past very simply. You click on, you visit our YouTube channel, and there's a search box. And if you don't know the search box, it's that little circle with a little stick at the end of it. It looks like a magnifying glass. All right, that's like the international symbol these days for search. Okay, so you click on that and a box opens. And you just go in there and you type whatever it is that you want to know about MS. It could be the impact of MS on the family, or it could be urology or neuropsychology, or it could be about the vision, about so many different things. It could be about physical therapy. You want a personal trainer. You need to know about any of the other types of complementary therapies. You could put it in there now. Aside from us having done over 270 programs, there are now over 300 videos on our YouTube channel. And for that, I have to thank this guy right there, Bill. You know, you guys are eating dessert, and I didn't want to send you out of the room without finishing your dessert, so I wanted to just bring up all these, you know, different things. So, you know, it's the seminar evaluations. Thank you. Very good, Ernest. Thank you. So these seminar evaluation forms, we do need you to fill these out. Chris is going to go around the room right now. He's going to help us out picking these up. We really do need you to fill it out and let us know what kind of programs you would like to see for the future as well. If there are enough of you in the room and it's something we have never done before, we are going to apply for a grant to get that to happen in the Miami area. But again, for our future programs, we do hope that you register to be there on time. If you want to bring a caregiver, if you need to bring a driver with you as well, let us know this. And when we ask you to reconfirm, please let us know that as well, because we don't want to say we're only going to have 50 seats at the table, I mean at a program, and 75 people show up. It just makes it a little difficult. So we do send out a request about a week before every program, and we ask you to fill that out. And by the way, we're having a program again in Miami this coming Saturday. It's a Spanish language program. And fortunately, we have a person on our board, Maria Zaldivar, who is going to lead that program in Spanish for all of you. And there are several people in this room that are registered to go to that program. But if you're not registered, we need you to do that tonight, because I have to give my final number to the hotel for tomorrow. Okay, and it's being held at the Intercontinental in Doral. So again, if you want to attend the Spanish language program, we have two speakers, Dr. Carlos Ramirez Calderon, and we also have a disability attorney, a Social Security disability attorney, who will be there to speak about all the Social Security disability laws. And for many of you, you might have questions. She's the person to ask. If she leaves there and you weren't there to ask that question, it's basically your own fault that you didn't register to attend. All right. So this is being left for you to take responsibility of what's going on with your illness, take charge of what's going on with your illness. This also leads to, you know, your health care options and what's available to you. There are a lot of things available out there for you, but you've got to take some responsibility and find what it is that is available for you. Okay. So again, I want to just thank you all for coming to this MS Views and News program, and we're here to provide you with education, information, and resources, and I want to say goodnight to everybody. Thank you.